Father in heaven, thank you so much for always being there for us, just for your love and for your forgiveness, and never failing us, even though we fail you at many times. You're still with us, and you'll never leave us nor forsake us. So Father, thank you right now for this new year and for this time that we can look into your word. I know a lot of people right now are suffering, struggling, just with anxiety, worry, fear, doubt, stress. Life is tough, Lord. And we need your peace. So I pray right now that your peace will be known to each and every person in this place. And that we would discover how we can have the peace of God, the peace with God, and the peace with others. So, Father, I pray that you'll fill me with your Spirit, that every word that comes out of my mouth will come directly from you, and that this message will come directly from you. This is not my message, but it's your message to each and every heart. And I know all of us will receive your word, but it might be a different response. But help each and every one of us respond in some way to your word being preached right here and right now. So bless this time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A while back I told the story of this woman who was out in her yard. She was using the weed whacker, you know. And all of a sudden she cut the tail off of her cat. Frantically, she runs into her house and she tells her husband, screaming, "What am I going to do? What am I going to do? The cat's tail. I chopped the cat's tail off." The husband was real calm. The husband says to the wife, "Look, let me tell you what to do. Get the tail, get the cat, and let's go to Walmart." She says, "Walmart? What good is that going to do, taking the cat's tail and the cat to Walmart?" He says, "Well, Walmart is the world's largest retailer." Where do you go? What do you do when you need something repaired in your life? What do you do and where do you go when your life seems to be falling apart? Where do you turn and what do you do when you're stressed, when you have doubt, fear, worry, anxiety? We live in a world filled with stress, worry, doubt, fear, anxiety. It affects all of us. How do we handle stress in our life? We need to get a grip on this, a handle. We need to learn how to handle the stresses of life this coming new year, because they're filled with them. What do we do? Where do we turn? After the elections, you know, students in our universities turn to tools for toddlers as a bizarre form of therapy. Universities are encouraging students to cry, cuddle with puppies, sip hot chocolate, this is for real, to soothe their fragile psyches. Top-notch schools are sending their devastated students back to their early childhood. Cornell University, for example, hosted a cry-in, complete with hot chocolate, tissues for disappointed Hillary Clinton supporters. The University of Pennsylvania brought in a puppy and a kitten for therapeutic cuddling. This is the University of Pennsylvania, folks. Tufts University held arts and crafts sessions for students. And then listen to this. The University of Michigan Law School scheduled an event called Post-Election Self-Care with Food and Play, with stress-busting self-care activities, including coloring, blowing bubbles, sculpting with Play-Doh, and positive card making. Folks, this is law school. Now, listen, I don't tell you this to make fun of or to mock, because honestly, when I hear things like this, it's really sad. It's sad, number one, because You know, these millennials will soon find out that in the real world, there are no safe zones. It's sad also because, honestly, that the millennials are not the only ones that have a tough time dealing with disappointments and when things don't go their way and when there's stress and anxiety and fear. They're not the only ones. People deal with it all the way from toddlers all the way to seniors, senior adults. And to be honest with you, many, 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 many Christians have a hard time dealing with stress. Very difficult, even Christians. I would venture to say that many people in this room, if not most, if not all, really, have a hard time dealing with stress, anxiety. It's actually normal for even Christians. But there's answers in the Bible. I think the saddest part about these universities, the saddest thing is that these same universities that are encouraging these stress-busting therapies and sessions will not allow the Bible on their campuses. They won't allow any preachers on campus or any talk of God on their campuses. That's the saddest part about this whole thing. Because God is the only one who can give real relief from stress, anxiety, worry, fear, doubt. God can. But yet, these universities ban the Bible. I believe that what the world needs more than anything else right now is peace. Peace. Turn in your Bibles to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4, it's one of my favorite passages of Scripture. I constantly go to this Scripture when I feel stressed. I'm not immune from stress, certainly not anxiety. Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 to 9. Says, therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. I entreat, or I beg, Euodia, and I entreat, or beg, Syntyche, to agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel together with Clement, and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication has to do with your request, your petitions to God, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And verse 7 is key. Highlight this verse. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, hard to understand, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Memorize that verse. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is holy, lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things. Don't just hear it and study it. Practice these things. And the God of peace will be with you. Notice you have to practice these things, though. Whatever is said in these verses before, practice these things, and the peace of God, God of peace, will be with you. Now, it's important for us to understand and realize that when the Bible talks about peace, it talks about three dimensions of peace. There are three dimensions of peace. One is peace with God. Peace with God is a vertical dimension. It has to do with our relationship with God. We have to have peace with God. If we're going to have eternal life or salvation, we need to have peace with God. We need to be at peace with God, right? Then there's peace with others. That's on a horizontal dimension. That's horizontal. It's you and I. You and I. Okay? We need to have peace with one another. And the third is the peace of God. And this takes place internally. You know, what you're feeling inside, but the worry and the stress and the fear and the doubt and all that. So let's take a look at these three dimensions. And the first is peace with God. Obviously, this is the most important. Because you really can't have peace with others and peace internally, the peace of God, unless you have peace with God. Peace of God, peace with God. This has to do with our relationship with God. While God loves us, He is actually filled with indignation because of our sinfulness. God can't stand sin, and every time we sin, we offend God. And there's a conflict that takes place between us and God. In fact, Romans 1:18 says, "The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and the wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness." In his classic book called Peace with God, written over 50 years ago, Billy Graham, I think, hit it on the head. He said the greatest warfare going on in the world today is between mankind and God. The greatest warfare going on today is between mankind and God. People may not realize that they're at war with God. But if they don't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, you are at war with God because your sins have not been taken care of. But there's good news. The good news is found in Romans 5:1. It says, "Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." You see, because of what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross, you and I can now be at peace with God. The God, our Father, poured out His wrath, His fury, His indignation on His own Son, who died on the cross in our place as our sin substitute. And so Colossians 1:20 says that Jesus reconciled Himself to all things, making peace through His blood shed on the cross. When we accept Christ as our personal Savior, we have peace with God. We can have peace with God. Number two, the second dimension of peace is peace with others. This is interesting because look at verse 2 again. It says, "I entreat." That word means I plead with you. I'm pleading with you, Euodia, and I'm pleading with you, Syntyche, to agree in the Lord. "Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are written in the book of life." Evidently, these two women had a disagreement and their conflict overflowed in the church. It happens. And even though we as Christians, we're Christians, we may not always get along. Folks, I grew up in churches. And I can tell you that there are some churches out there that are actually war zones. They are. And I praise God for this church because there aren't any conflicts in this church. Praise God for that. Because conflicts can really divide a church and destroy a church. When God's people don't get along in churches, I've seen churches split right down the middle, just like the Hatfields and the McCoys. You pick a side and they're at war. They don't, this side doesn't speak to this side doesn't speak to this side, and that's not of God. And so we don't know what this argument was all about, but Paul was obviously concerned about it. He wrote it in the Bible. Here are two Christian ladies who actually served the Lord with the Apostle Paul, ministered with the Apostle Paul, who had a disagreement in the church. And evidently, it started overflowing into the church. It affected the church in some way. So Paul had to say something about it. Now, there's something that bothers me, though, here. When you think about this and you read this, now, this is a letter to the church of Philippi, and in it, Paul has dealt with some very important issues. So why in the midst of such an important letter does Paul stick in something so personal about these two ladies in the congregation? How would you like your name in the Bible if the Bible had not been written already? And I just decide I'm going to write one of the books of the Bible, and I'm just going to write your name right in there. You know, just going to, let's see here. That's right, Kathy. Kathy and Jill, you know, you guys, you know, need to get along here. And, you know, you're just really... I gave those two as an example because they're the two sweetest people. They would never cause conflict or fight, right? So, but shouldn't he have tried to solve the problem much more discreetly and privately? Why mention it in this letter that millions of people now have already read for nearly 2,000 years. Maybe it's important that the church communicate to the world that we don't handle disappointments and disagreements the same way the world does, and that we're able to find common ground and agree to work in harmony with one another. Now notice what Paul does, and notice what he doesn't do. Number one, he doesn't take sides. That's a good thing. When people come to me, if there's a disagreement in the church or two people are not getting along and it spreads into the church, I will not take sides. I don't care if I'm closer to this person and not as much so to this person. I'm not going to say, you're right, you're out of here. Man, what are you doing? The Apostle Paul doesn't say, Syntyche's right, Yodia, you're wrong, you're out of here. And so, don't take sides. If you know that two people are not getting along and they might have had a fight or whatever, and you know, don't go out talking to the person and talking about the other person. Don't take sides. The worst thing that you can do as a counselor or a person who is talking to one of the people that's had a conflict is to talk bad about the other person and just take sides. I don't care how close you are to that person. Don't take sides. It's a good thing to follow Paul's example. Number two, he doesn't pull rank. He doesn't say, I'm the Apostle Paul here. You know, if you two don't get along, Yodia and Syntyche, then you're both out of here. He doesn't do that either. Instead, he encourages them to find common ground, something that they can agree on. He says, I plead with you to agree with each other in the Lord. You can always agree to disagree. You see, and you might need to compromise your opinions. We're so diverse. I think diversity is a great thing. But when you try to force your will on another person, then it becomes a problem. And you've got to compromise and agree. The Apostle Paul wrote in Romans 12:18, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. And the fourth thing that Paul does is that he appoints a third party to intervene. In verse 3, he called that third party a true companion. We don't know who he was, but whoever he was, he was a peacemaker. And God tells us that we should be peacemakers, kind of mediate, try to help each other see the other person's perspective. That's all you need to do. And that's why in Matthew 5:9, it says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Now, the third dimension is what I really want to focus on. And that's the peace of God, peace within. How do we deal with stress, worry, fear, anxiety? Verse 7, like I said, is the key. Look at it says, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. The peace that comes from the Lord can banish all worry and distress from our hearts and our minds. The heart is the seat of our emotions and of our desires and of our will. Not only can it banish anxiety and anguish and fear from our hearts and minds, it can keep it away. This is good news, folks. In other words, it will not allow anxiety and despondency and fear to sneak back in, because the peace of God can act like a soldier on guard to protect your heart and mind. Now picture that you've got your emotions, your heart is the seat of your emotions. Your mind, emotions, your will, your desires, your values, what's important to you, what you love. The peace of God can be like a soldier, a guard, to guard your heart. And so the anxiety and the stress cannot get back in your heart to cause damage. You see, it will not allow the anxiety, the despondency, and fear to sneak back in. So once you get rid of it, it can also stand guard to keep it away. The peace of God is stronger than any worry, any fear of the flesh, just as God is greater than our situations and circumstances. So is the God of peace greater than our inward worries and fears. We can experience perfect inward peace and tranquility in the midst of the most trying circumstances and severe tribulations. This doesn't seem possible nor rational, does it? That we can be in perfect peace. We can be so calm, even though the world is caving in around us, it's so chaotic and violent, and the storms are all around us, we can actually be as calm as a little baby. It doesn't sound rational, does it? It doesn't sound possible. That's why it says the peace of God surpasses all understanding. Surpasses all comprehension. It's hard to comprehend and understand how our world can seem to be collapsing around us, yet we can be perfectly calm and completely composed. The peace of God can provide that blessing. There once was a king who offered a prize to the artist that could paint the best picture of peace. Many artists tried, but the king narrowed it down to only two pictures that he liked the most. So he had to decide between these two pictures. The first picture, the one picture, was a scene of a calm lake surrounded by mountains. Beautiful mountains, such a calm, not even a ripple on the lake. Mountains around, beautiful mountains, a beautiful sky, blue sky, with fluffy clouds scattered throughout. What a perfect picture of peace. The second picture, though, had mountains too, but these mountains were rough and bare. Above was an angry sky from which rain fell and in which lightning flashed across the sky. Down the side of the mountain tumbled a foaming, rushing waterfall. This didn't look very peaceful at all. But when the king looked, he saw behind the waterfall a tiny bush in the crack, in the crevice of the rock behind the waterfall, and in the bush a mother bird had built a nest. There in the midst of a rough, angry waterfall sat the mother bird on her nest in perfect peace. Of course, the king picked the second picture. When asked why, the king said, "Peace doesn't mean to be a place where there is no noise, trouble, or hard work. Peace means to be in the midst of all those things and still be calm in your heart. This is the real meaning of peace. Around us might be turbulent, but we can be at perfect peace as the peace of God stands guard in our heart. Do you want to experience that peace of God in your life? These verses give us the greatest stress buster. And you know what it is, folks? It's prayer. It's as simple as that. We as Christians, we don't Do you really pray to God, or you just ask God for things? So many Christians don't understand the power of prayer. I'm going to tell you. Verse 6, look at it. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Now, there are three parts to prayer. Prayer is actually a synonym for praise. Prayer is talking to God, making a connection with God. You can go through words, you can go through the motions all you want. You know, thank you for this food, yay God, amen. You know, well, did you really make that connection with God? Okay. But prayer is three things, should be include three things. Praise, worship. Prayer is worshiping God. And worship has to do with making a connection with God. Our petitions, our supplications, they're our requests. We ask God. And then with thanksgiving. Should always be with thanksgiving. I can't think honestly of anything more calming in my life than prayer. When I'm stressed out, when things are seem overwhelming, and just things are just seem to be caving in, or you're not feeling good, or you're just, I mean, things aren't going your way. If I just pray, sincerely pray, I'm not just talking about going through the motions or saying a few words to God. I pour out my heart to God. And I will tell you, as I am so sincere in my prayer, and I do have faith. Otherwise, I wouldn't spend so much time in prayer. But I do. And you have no idea. Because when I pray this way, I pray by myself. And I pray for a long time, and I really pour out my heart to God. And I will tell you, that is, it's like a calming sense comes over me like you can't even imagine unless you've experienced yourself. I feel like, wow, I am good now. Because I just talked with the God of the universe who created me and who can take care of everything. He knows me better than anyone. He can take care of things. He wants what's best for me. And I'm telling you, if you've never experienced that, why don't you get down on your knees and pray like you've never prayed before? Have a good old talk with God. He's not so concerned about the words. You know, he's concerned about your heart. He's concerned about really your sincerity. And really, if you really have a relationship with God, then really try it. And you will just feel a sense of calmness like you've maybe never experienced before in your life. God always answers your prayers. He always answers my prayers. It may not be the way I want him to answer it, but he always answers my prayer. And the reason he may not answer it always the way I want it to be answered, because he knows what's best for me. In fact, I don't want him to answer always the way I want it to be. I want him to answer my prayers the way he thinks it should be answered, because he knows what's best, even better than I do. Sometimes we don't pray, and James 4:2 says, you have not because you ask not. You don't even pray about it. So you're certainly not going to get what you need or what you want if you don't pray about it. 1 Peter 5, 6, and 7 says, humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in proper time, casting all your anxiety on him. Casting all your cares upon him. Casting all your anxieties on him, like the song that we sang. Now, we cast our anxieties on God like we throw a ball to someone. Catch. Take my anxieties. Right? Now, if I throw a ball to Ed and, you know, he catches the ball. Now, what am I doing? It's actually, I'm saying, okay, the ball's in your court. The ball, now you have to make the next move. See? And so when we cast our anxieties on God, we've cast the ball to him, it's all in his court now. He can do with these anxieties. Now, what's he going to do? Okay? With those anxieties, with the problems in my life and the things going on in my life to relieve the stress. We let him make the next move and rest in knowing that he will respond in the proper time by giving us that which is for our own good. There are three friends who went deep sea fishing, and suddenly a storm arose out of nowhere, and the storm was so severe that it threatened to sink the boat before they could return to shore. And two of the men began to pray right away. Third guy just sat there watching the growing waves, and his companions begged him to pray. He said, I haven't talked to God in a long time. I haven't been to church in a long time. You don't want me to pray. But his friends insisted. He said, I want you to pray. You need to pray. I mean, we're going down. And so he prayed this prayer. Oh, Lord, I haven't asked you for anything in nearly 15 years. If you will deliver us safely from this storm, though, I promise you that I will not bother you again for another 15 years. Isn't that the way some Christians are, though? You know, we don't even consider prayer. That's the answer. So many Christians don't understand the power of prayer. God wants us to bother him, by the way. He wants to be involved in our life, in every aspect and detail of our life. A study of older adults done by the University of Florida revealed that their greatest weapon in the war against stress is prayer. 96% of the senior adults interviewed for this study chose prayer as their top tool for dealing with stress. Verse 6 encourages us to pray with thanksgiving. In other words, we're to focus on the good things. In fact, look at verse 8. It says, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, so forth, think on these things. You think on the positive things. You think about the good things. You don't have a negative heart. You don't think of the negative things. Or you don't think about and dwell on the things that are making you miserable. James 1:17 says, every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Every single thing good in your life has come from God. Dwell on those things. Dwell on your blessings. God is good. Dwell on all the blessings so that you might be able to say, I'm too blessed to be stressed. I know Randy and Kathy had that sign in the front yard. I don't know if you still do, but it's a great, great sign. It says, we're too blessed to be stressed. You see, because you focus on the blessings. You don't focus on the bad stuff. Psalm 4:1, David prays, answer me when I call, O God, of my righteousness. You have given me relief when I was in distress. Be gracious to me and hear my prayer. Again, there are three parts to David's prayer. Number one is praise. Number two is appreciation. Number three is requests. David begins with praising God when he says, O God of my salvation. And the reason we pray with thanksgiving is because it takes our eyes off of ourselves. The reason we're so stressed out all the time, the reason that we deal with disappointments is because us, me. And so we're so self-focused. And so when we're self-focused, that's when we get worried. Because we can't solve some of the problems. We're not in control all the time. So take our eyes off of ourselves and put them on the Lord. That's going to relieve stress. It's not about you. It's about God. I think there would be a lot less stress in the world if more people had the attitude of, it's not about me. Take your eyes off of yourself and put them on God, and you'll see stress relief. A few years ago, a man almost drowned in a storm at sea in the Gulf of Mexico. He said he was swimming far from shore, trying to reach his drifting boat. The waves were 7-8 feet high. dark skies, gale-force winds, and lightning. And he continued his effort to swim back to shore, but it wasn't getting him anywhere. The harder he swam, the more he drifted out to sea. Finally, he heard God speak to him. You know what God said to him? Do you know how to tread water? Somehow, he hadn't thought about that. If he continued his frantic effort to swim back to shore, he would have exhausted his strength and gone down. And in all sorts of situations, we make matters worse by our own frantic efforts to save ourselves instead of trusting God and standing still. That's why the Bible says, Psalm 46:10, be still and know that I am God. A couple days ago, Friday night, one of my favorite days of my life, I got a chance to go over 10 o'clock at night from 10 to 12, and I just held Quinn in my arms. I wouldn't let her down. I cuddled with her and just held her in my arms. First, she started looking at me, and I was talking to her the whole time. Of course, she listened and heard me. She can't talk yet, though. She's only a week old. And so I gave her a break on that. I was okay with that. But I know she was listening to me, eyes wide open, looking at me. Of course, you think she's smiling, but it might be gas. Then I would you know, pick her up, hold her right by my chest, and she was so peaceful, so content. She didn't have a worry in the world. She didn't cry, whimper, nothing. She was the most peaceful person in the world in Pop-Pop's arms. She was. You could tell she was at peace. She didn't have a worry in the world. Now, folks, I'm thinking to myself, this poor girl, I mean, she can't walk, she can't talk, she can't feed herself, she can't clothe herself, she can't go to the bathroom on her own. She can't do anything on her own. And when you're not in control, that's when people get stressed out. This little girl should be a basket case by now, right? Because she can't do anything on her own. But yet she was the most peaceful person in the world in Pop-Pop's arms. How can that be? In the same way, I want you to picture your life in the arms of God, because you are. You're in God's hands. He is holding you in his arms so tight. There's no reason why we should have fear, anxiety, stress, worry, when we're in the arms of God, the God of the universe, who loves us so much. He even loves me more than I love Quinn. That's hard to believe. Okay? But he does. And we can just stay in his arms, listen to him, talk with him, and even though we can't control the events that happen around us, we can't do anything about it. The thing we worry about the most are things that we can't control. That's kind of dumb. We should take lessons from Quinn. Just be at peace in God's arms. Let's bow for prayer. Father in heaven, I ask that you'll give peace, the peace of God, to each person in this room, that the peace of God would guard our hearts. Not allow that stress to get inside our hearts, our minds. That we would just rest in your arms, casting all your care, all of our care, upon you. Thank you, Lord, for that promise. And you know what's best for us. And so I pray that if there's anyone here that doesn't have peace with God, that they would come to know you this morning as their personal Savior, so that they too can be at peace with you. That they would have peace with others, that they might experience the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now with heads bowed and eyes closed, there may be some people here who really don't know if they have peace with God. If they've really come to know Jesus as their personal Savior, if Jesus lives in their heart, do you know that if you were to die today, you'd be in heaven? Do you have the peace with God? Has Jesus Christ forgiven you of your sins? Have you applied the blood of Jesus Christ to your life and accepted Jesus into your life by faith? Are you a Christian? Do you know it? Are you sure? If you're just not sure, but you'd like to be sure, I'd like to ask you this morning, if you want to have peace with God, would you just raise your hand and put it back down? Raise it up and put it back down. God has spoken to your heart. Yes. 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 I'm going to pray a prayer with those who raise their hand, that if you want to have peace with God, to be at peace with God, I'm going to say a prayer. And in this prayer, you repeat after me this prayer, praying this prayer to God. And God will come into your heart and your life, and you'll have peace with God. The Bible says, whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So I invite you to pray this prayer to have peace with God. Dear Heavenly Father, I know that I'm a sinner, and I need you. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins and rose from the grave. I accept you into my life. Be my personal Savior. I want to be at peace with you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. With heads bowed and eyes closed, if you just prayed that prayer for the first time and God is in your heart and you know you have peace with God now that you prayed and asked Him to come into your life, would you just raise your hand and put it back down? God spoke to you. You prayed that prayer. Yes, yes. God, that's fantastic. That's great. Now, many of you here may have stresses that are so overwhelming. It's so overwhelming stuff to deal with. Would you pray to God right now? Would you just, you can come up here at the altar and pray. You can come forward. I'd love to pray with you. Those of you who raised your hand just a second ago, would you come up front here and so that I can pray with you and help you understand the decision that you just made? Would you come? This is an invitation time. This is when you respond to God's word. In just a few minutes here, just come up and let me pray with you again, and or you can pray at the altar. It's open.